Hello and welcome back to my YouTube channel where we learn all about derivatives and quantitative finance. Today we're going to learn about exotic options, things like compound options, chooser options, gap options, barrier options, look-back options, quantos, and many more. In today's class, we're going to learn all about exotic options. So I guess the first thing I should do is probably to explain what an exotic option is. Simple put and call options, or combinations of them, are called vanilla or plain vanilla options. These have standardized properties and trade actively. The alternatives to these are referred to as exotic options. Typically, these are over-the-counter derivatives and have various non-standard features. Now, it's worth being clear that exotic options aren't sort of better or necessarily more interesting than vanilla options. In fact, when I first started learning about them as a student, I thought, well, this is the thing that I will find most interesting. But in truth, most of the exposures that you want, you can probably get with vanilla options. These are just there for very specific market needs. So exotics serve market niches, including specific hedging needs, tax accounting, legal or regulatory needs, or they offer investors unique payoffs in particular market circumstances that are not easily accessible to investors were these products not available. Non-standard features include a hybrid of American or European style exercise capabilities, alternative payoffs or payoffs that do not depend precisely on one strike price, fixed payout options above a specified strike price, or those with a payoff on the average performance of the underlying over the option's life. If you'd like to learn more about this topic, or derivatives in general, all of these classes are based on my book, which is called Trading and Pricing Financial Derivatives. I've put a link to it in the description below. So the first exotic option that we'll talk about will be Bermudan options. Bermudan options are a cross between American and European style options. They're named Bermudan options because Bermuda is physically between the US and Europe. These options can be exercised on certain dates during the life of the option, often monthly, for example. Bermudan options offer the sellers more control over when an option can be exercised against them, and therefore the contract is less expensive for the buyer than an American-style option would be, but obviously not as inexpensive as a European option, which only allows exercise on the expiration date. These options can of course be priced using the binomial tree, where at particular nodes early exercise is a possibility and at other nodes it's not. The next one we'll talk about are forward start options. A forward start option is an option that starts at some point in the future. The exercise price is typically set at the current price at the beginning of the option's life. Employee stock options are an example of a forward start option. The other main purpose of trading them is to gain an exposure to forward volatility. Forward start options can be valued with a modified version of the Black-Scholes model. And of course, if you're interested in learning about the Black-Scholes model, you can click the link above to see the video that I've made on that topic. Okay, so next up are compound options. Compound options are options on options. So you can have a call on a call option, a put on a call option, a call on a put, or a put on a put. The underlying asset in the first option is simply another option. Compound options allow buyers to effectively implement their strategy with greater leverage than on a simple options position. And they're cheaper at inception than a straight options position for the full time frame. However, because you make a second payment when you exercise the first option, the full amount of the premiums paid on the two options will be greater than the premium on one option for the entire duration. Right, well, next up we have chooser options. Chooser options allow the buyer, after a specified time, to choose if the option is a call option or a put option. This is particularly attractive if the underlying is expected to experience significant volatility and potentially in either direction. This is riskier than a straddle strategy. With a chooser option, you might choose the call after it has rallied, after the underlying has rallied, but by the time expiry is approaching, the underlying may have reversed direction and fallen, and you might end the contract out of the money. Whereas with a straddle, you have a live put and a live call option right up until maturity. And so for this reason, chooser options are cheaper than straddles. But of course, the reason they're cheaper is that they're not quite as good. Okay, so barrier options. Barrier option payoffs depend on whether the underlying hits a certain level, which we call the barrier, before the expiration date. These options can either knock in or knock out. A knock-in option has no intrinsic value until the underlying touches the barrier price, at which point it becomes a vanilla option. A knock-out option is like a vanilla option, but if the underlying goes through the barrier price, it then becomes worthless, so it knocks out rather than knocking in. There are 8 types of barrier options. They can be up and out or down and out, calls or puts, and they can be down and in or up and in, puts or calls. Barrier options are path dependent options because their value depends not just on where the underlying ends at expiration, but on the previous prices of the underlying during the life of the option. Barrier options are always cheaper than an otherwise similar option without a barrier. As an example, if you were bullish on, we'll say, Facebook stock over the next 1 year time frame, but were confident that it would not exceed $250 per share over that period, you might be happy to buy a 1 year up and out call option. So that's a knockout call option, an up and out call option, with a strike around the current price, we'll say $150 at the time of making this video, but a knockout barrier $250. Hopefully you can see how this has some similarity to something like a call spread, but this payoff is considerably worse, right? Because with a call spread, if you've watched my video or if you already understand spreads, with a call spread, when the price goes up to the what we're calling the knockout level, instead with the call spread, you end up not making any more money, while with a knockout, you end up invalidating the entire option. So hopefully it's obvious that this is worse than a call spread. And so if it's worse or has less features than a call spread, it should obviously be worth less or cost less to the buyer of the option. Now, the Greeks on barrier options behave quite differently than those on vanilla options. If you compare an up and out call option like we just talked about to a vanilla call option, as the stock price moves up, a vanilla call will increase in value, while an up and out call is affected by two opposing forces. As the stock price moves up, the up and out call's payoff becomes potentially larger, just like with the vanilla call option, but the upward move simultaneously threatens to destroy the value of the contract by moving it closer to the knockout barrier. This conflict makes the option's value very sensitive to the stock's movement as it gets close to the barrier. And delta can flip rapidly from positive to negative at these points, making these options very difficult to hedge. Barrier option values can decrease with increasing volatility, unlike vanilla calls and puts. The up and out call described earlier becomes more likely to get knocked out near the barrier as volatility increases. Even though the investor is long volatility relative to the strike level, they are short volatility relative to the barrier. So that's it for barrier options. Next up, we'll talk about binary options. Binary options are often also referred to as digital options. Binary options are discontinuous payoff options. An example would be a payoff of X if the underlying price is above the strike price, otherwise a payout of zero. So you either get kind of a one or zero, a binary payout. So the owner of a binary call option gets a fixed payoff amount if the underlying price is above a preset level, the strike price, but The payoff does not rise if the underlying is well above the strike price. Instead, it's a fixed payoff of X. So we'll say, for example, we could have a $1 payoff, and you'll either get $1 or you'll get nothing. There's no other possible payout. So if you take a look at the image on the screen right now, and that shows the payoff of these things are difficult for dealers to hedge well, particularly when the underlying trades close to the strike near maturity. So that's binary options. Next up, we have gap options. A gap option is a type of barrier option where the strike making the option exercisable differs from the strike used to calculate the payoff. Gap call options will pay off the difference between the stock price and strike price 1 when the stock price is greater than strike price 2. A modified Black-Scholes formula can be used to price this style of option. Look-back options. So look-back options payoffs depend on maximums or minimums of the underlying asset price points over the option's life. So once again, this is a path-dependent option that allows the option owners to buy at the low or sell at the high over the life of the option. The life of the option being from the contract first being agreed upon through to the expiration date. There are two types of look-back options, floating strike and fixed strike. For floating strike look-back calls, the exercise price is the minimum stock price reached over the life of the option. For floating strike look-back puts, the exercise price is the maximum stock price reached over the life of the option. For fixed strike options, the strike is fixed as with a vanilla option, but for fixed strike look-back calls, the owner gets to exercise at the point when the underlying asset price is at its highest level over the life of the option. For fixed strike look-back puts, the owner gets to exercise at the underlying asset's lowest price over the life of the option. While these options sound like you can't lose with them, they are of course priced in a rational market and are considerably more expensive than vanilla options. Their high prices can be reduced by restricting the maximums and minimums used in calculating the payoffs, and these restricted versions are known as partial look-back options. Next up is Asian options. Asian option payoffs depend on the average price of the underlying over the option's life or some part of the option's life rather than the spot price of the underlying on the expiration date. The average can be calculated as either a geometric or arithmetic average. The primary advantage of Asian options is that they reduce the potential for singular episodes of market manipulation or one-off unusual price moves to undermine your investment thesis, which might have otherwise been accurate. Because of the volatility dampening effect of the averaging feature, these are usually cheaper than American or European options. Asian options are very common in the commodities space, particularly in options on oil. It's worth noting that they're just called Asian options. This doesn't actually mean that they're more popular in Asia or anything like that. They're globally traded. Okay, so next let's talk about rainbow options. Rainbow options are those where delivery at maturity can be on a choice of a number of assets. These are usually calls or puts on a best of or worst of a basket of Y underlying assets. This is also considered a type of correlation trading because the prices of these options are very sensitive to the correlation amongst the basket's constituents. Often Monte Carlo methods are used to value rainbow options. We'll now talk about basket options. Basket options have payoffs that depend on the performance of a basket of assets, such as a set of individual stocks or indices or a group of currencies. Typically, the owner of a basket option has the right but not the obligation to buy or sell a basket of underlying assets at maturity. These are commonly used for currency hedging in institutions with varied currency exposures and often end up being cheaper than individual options purchased on each currency. Okay, so next up we have quantos. Quanto is short for quantity adjusting options. Quantos are derivatives where the underlying is denominated in a currency other than that in which the option is settled. A quanto has an embedded currency forward with a variable notional amount. They're attractive to investors who wish to have exposure to a foreign asset, but without the corresponding foreign exchange risk. These are used when investors expect the underlying foreign asset to perform well, but do not expect that the foreign country's currency will perform well over the same time frame. Quanto futures, quanto options, and quanto swaps are available. Well, that's it for this video. There's a bit more covered in the book, which I've linked to below if you want to read more on this topic. As you know, the rules of YouTube state that if you make it all the way to the end of the video, which you have, that you have to hit the like button. So go ahead and do that quickly. If you want to see more videos like this, do click the subscribe button. If you want to be notified whenever I upload a new video, hit the bell button, which is next to the subscribe button. Have a great day and thanks for watching. Bye.